This morning, my message is entitled, Jesus in Our Midst. And I'm asking Pastor Ray if he will read for us our text from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 23. Pastor Ray?
Then, the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled, for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, Peace be with you. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained.
Amen. There are so many distractions in today's culture that distract Christians and believers and keep their eyes away from the awareness of Jesus' presence. And there are also a lot of oppositional voices crying out, and they demand our attention. Now, I think of the word bedlam. If you can picture an orchestra with everybody playing something, whenever they're tuning up, it sounds like this. Everybody's out of tune. And sometimes when I feel torn in life, that's exactly how I feel, like there's bedlam going on around me. I may feel that way after about, let's say, 18 to 22 phone calls in a day. That may get to me where I start to feel that way. Now, media images. Now, they're not just visual images, because I can give you word pictures that'll break your heart. And they do this all the time. They distract us. For example, this last week they talked about a four-year-old girl who had a black eye and had dried blood on one corner of her mouth, deep purple bruises all over her body. An investigator asked her what her name was, and the most startling answer that I've ever heard from a child, she said, My name is Idiot. And she lived with her mother and live-in boyfriend, and people say that she was called idiot so often by them that that's the name that sprang to her mind when she was asked her name. Now that mental picture of that abused child is hard to erase. It's just a verbal thing. They're not allowed legally to show their pictures, so we see it in our minds. And today's sermon is kind of like that. We're trying to paint a mental picture that will also become indelibly imprinted in our mind and heart. Jesus is present in the time of trouble. And that's something I know from my years of experience in walking with Him, and I know also that it's in His Word very clearly. The greater the extremity that life throws to you, the more likelihood that He is present. And he will come into the midst of your distractions. So we have to develop a little practice of seeing him. You know, I think sometimes we are walking among the unseen. I've had children, my own children. You know, there would be events in their lives, and I wouldn't get it. You know, and then later on, the Holy Spirit would get me like the Missouri mule. You know, hit me in the head with a 2x4, get my attention and say, Now this is what I was saying there, Phil, and your children were speaking my word to you. Wow. And all of a sudden, the whole event that I framed around it were wrong. It wasn't chaotic. It was the presence of Jesus. Amen. So we practice seeing him, focusing on him. I guarantee you, you will never be the same. I'm starting off my message today by saying that we're so concerned with doing the morally right thing to be seen righteous in the eyes of people around us that we sometimes forget that he himself is present. in all of life's events. No matter how mundane or how alone or alienated you felt when those things were happening, he was there. And his presence isn't dependent upon how you feel. Thank God for that. He is in the midst of us all the, can you say that with me? All the time. Amen. Notice in Matthew 18:20, let's say that together. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them. Now, just taking the text that we worked with this morning, he is present when you cannot sense him. Now, I would suggest to you that when these disciples gathered together and locked the door, that he was already in the room. You know, he didn't just come magically. He was already there. Now, this is hard to understand, but we'll keep working on this till it begins to make some sense. So when the doors were shut, the disciples were assembled. So there's a key here to understanding his presence. Even when you can't see him, you assemble in his name, he's there. Okay. He's not limited by our five senses. We got him. I listened, but look up at me for a minute and say, eyes, ears, taste, smell, touch. Okay. The five senses. Aristotle, Greek philosopher, you hear me talk about this a lot because we live in an empirical culture. These reporters say, well, I don't believe it unless I see it. Well, I say, well, geez, you pick up political biases that you don't see. You're clueless. You pick those up. You can't see those. So, there's a lot of hypocrisy out there. But Thomas made the empirical challenge. I must see and touch. You know, he was a child of his age. Amen. And so he's not limited by, first of all, the five senses, and he's not limited by locked doors. He came and stood in their midst. He was not bound by the law of physics. I like that idea. And time and space were not a concern for him. Okay. He's not limited by your lack of faith in the supernatural. Like the young man I was telling you about this morning as we started the service, he's sitting there like this all the time. We talk about supernatural things, so I told him a few things. Just experiences. He said, I never experienced it. In other words, the tree falls in the forest. He didn't hear it, therefore it didn't exist. You know, it's craziness. Just because you don't hear it doesn't mean it didn't happen. You know, just because you didn't hear the sound doesn't mean it didn't make a sound. There's so much of what I call self-centeredness, narcissism, and immaturity in our culture that they think they have to experience it themselves. It's kind of like the Islamic law that says that there's no rape that happened unless five men saw it. Well, there were five accomplices as far as I'm concerned. Idiots. Confronted by the supernatural, automatically the head shakes. And I had a guy ask, told me he didn't believe that God healed. And I said, have you ever seen a scar? Is that a testimony to healing or what? You know, craziness. So time after time, we have to resort to faith to explain things we don't understand. I could just go on and on about that. And the point D in my message here of these present, you cannot sense them, is that he is not limited by your inability to understand. Human reason doesn't limit him. I was told by this by Walter Martin, my professor of hermeneutics, which is logic, basically, from the biblical perspective. And he said, the Bible is not illogical, it is a-logical. Now, he uses the A-H word from Latin that means above. It's a preposition, above logic. So you can go ahead and logic him all the way to the top of your ability, and you still won't have reached Mount Everest yet, because he is above you still. And that's how it works. Can you figure out how to fit the infinite into this finite mind? How can I put God in this little, I've got to limit him by putting him in, well, you saw Bruce Almighty, so you know what I'm talking about. He thought he could do it, and it didn't work so good. But there is, human reason just doesn't deter him. And then Pilate's question, the philosopher's question, what is truth? That, he is a truth, in human flesh, standing before him, and Pilate asked the question. He could have answered, he could have been the world's greatest philosopher, Pilate, but he missed it. But Jesus is able to communicate his presence in unusual ways. One of the favorite stories that I've told in my book about two little twins that were tragically murdered by their father, who got in a car and drove it recklessly to get drugs, and then on the way home he hit a semi head-on because he was under the influence of drugs when they buried those two little kids, or twins, just as they were putting the caskets into the little kids' caskets into the hearse, two butterflies come down, land on the casket, there for a moment, slid away. Then they drive on down to the gravesite, and right in the, as they unload the caskets to say their sad final goodbyes to these beautiful little children, two more butterflies show up again. Is God present in that? Is God present in that? Yeah. See, and the butterfly is a promise. It's the oldest symbol of Christianity. I don't know if you're aware of it or not. The anchor is a very old one, the Greek anchor. That's an old one. But the butterfly, oh yeah. It's not uncommon for them to have buried their children in catacombs with butterflies engraved on the stone. Yeah, same thing. Same thing. Same thing. And so it's just a promise. It's a hope that we have. Okay, unusual ways that God communicates. Number second, Jesus in our midst, he is present in our gatherings or our assemblies. And notice that 19th verse again, in the same day in the evening, being the first day of the week, and underline the word first, that's important, that's a Sunday, not Saturday, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled. Okay, so assembly and worship by those who love him draw his presence. You might, one way to put it, you might say, well, when you came, you brought him with you. I know I've been in church services where I thought people brought something other than Jesus too, you know. It just depends on what they're into, and I don't want to know, you know. So these high worship songs, they're the ones that drew Lois and I into the charismatic movement. Do you mind turning that on for just a second? Remember, Alleluia, that was the one that really really drew us into that movement because of the... just Alleluia. Big, tough lyric. These are high worship songs. And I don't care. You want to say praise the Lord in Japanese? Hallelujah. Say it in Chinese. Hallelujah. Say it in Russian. Hallelujah. Do you understand? It's a universal word. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you. Beautiful. These are vertical songs. They're directed directly to God. I like to think of them as throne room songs, you know. Gospel songs that we were raised on, Lois and I were raised on these, are about God and Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. I'm not making fun of this. I'm saying that that's a song that goes horizontally. It doesn't go up. And sometimes if I'm by myself, I might sing it like this. What a friend I have in you, Lord. See, that makes it high worship again. You know, you can do into that with almost any song, you know. Exhortive songs, or like the one I just mentioned, that's like that. Testimony songs, I love this one. It was written by an old Baptist boy 100 years ago. He said, "My faith is built on nothing less than Jesus' love and righteousness, Jesus' blood and righteousness." I love that. It's a great testimony song. We're teaching people how to put words that sound like testimony so that they can get them out loud. One guy told me, he said, "Well, I pray to God all the time, but I think it. I think prayers." Well, I said, "What's wrong with saying them out loud? Was there something wrong with that?" Your kids like to hear you bless them out loud, you know. Your friends like to hear that occasionally. There's nothing wrong with that. Didn't he say, when we're gathered in his name, we're two or three, he says, "I am there in the midst of them." Now, ritual and routine services, programs, you see a sheepfold program. You won't see that. We don't have any programs. Because that just, to me, it symbolizes something that's not good. To me, I don't want to I want to be so spontaneous we can do whatever we want to. That's just how it works. So, what if we simply took time to allow Jesus to show up? The ancient Quakers, the early Quakers in this colonial America, would sit for hours waiting for God to show up, waiting for a word from God. And they didn't have a preacher designated to bring a word. Anybody in there would just stand up and start saying the word of the Lord. That's the old Quakers approach. Now, that would be kind of scary, but for some of us, because we like to be in control, we'd like to have 60 deadly minutes. I'm sorry, 60-minute services. Sorry, I missed that. Okay, and what if we limited time for your favorite football game? Your football game is over. It's 60 minutes. We just click off the TV. I think we'd have people mad as a wet hen. We might only be two-thirds through the half of the last inning, you know. Yes. Two and a half, 3 hours. Amazing. Of course, you don't forget the commercials. Okay, so he's present in our gatherings or assemblies. He's present in our prayers. There's so many things that come up in my mind when I'm going through these today. I just put a few ideas down. James 4:8. Read that with me, please. "Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded." So, we pray to and through Jesus in our prayers to God. And Matthew, that's Matthew 14:13. "Whatsoever you ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." Read this with me right here, verse 14. "If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." So in the name of Jesus, darkness goes. Ask in his name, darkness goes. Ask him in his name, troubles are diminished. The mountains are now molehills, you understand. His name, burdens are lifted. We used to sing that old song, "Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. In his name, sorrows are comforted." And in 25 years, have I seen that through the work at Kelly Robb Cummins Funeral Home? Man, I've seen people. We can't heal everyone, but we can leave them in a better place each time we get to spend 22 hours with them. And I'm grateful for that time. Altogether, we've spent well over 1,000 hours in 25 years working with people that are hurt. And Jesus is always present with his Holy Spirit to comfort the brokenhearted. I don't even have to say it. The brokenhearted is a symbol. And we automatically start our meetings with prayer in Jesus' name. He shows up. Call on him personally, as you would call on a good friend. Jeremiah 33:3. You heard me do a children's sermon a few years ago on that. "Call upon me," and say that with me, please. "Call upon me, and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know." So, in your heart of hearts, get alone. Call upon him. Talk to him. Do it. Tell him what's on your heart. He will hear. Unless the Bible's not true. Is the Bible true? Absolutely. It's a true thing. He will answer. He will hear an answer. Point four of my message is that he is present in our testimonies. Revelation 12:11. Now, this is the end time saints. they're being attacked by the enemy, even in the end time, the very last time, after, even at the end of the tribulation, I'm sorry, wrong word, at the end of the millennium, there will be a great battle. And it says, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of the testimony. It doesn't say RPGs. It doesn't say automatic rifles, Kalashnikovs, none of that. Blood of the Lamb, word of the testimony. That's how they overcome. They did not love their lives until their death. I love that. Every time I read that, I get goosebumps because I think of martyrdom that is happening on this planet right now. Right now. People are dying because they refuse to give up their love for Christ and testimony for Him. When you think about it, your personal testimony is irrefutable. When I was a young man and in my original church that I was raised in, I thought I had to proof text everything to the sinners, the people around me that didn't know the Lord. I thought I had to proof text it. No, you don't. All you have to do is go, this is what happened to me. He changed my life. I don't care if you're the world's finest Rabbi Zacharias, the greatest apologist in Christendom today. It doesn't matter. He can't refute your testimony. You can always come back and say, well, I don't care what you say because this happened to me. That's beautiful. Always remember that. When you're ever in doubt, go back to that. You know, when the young man was so skeptical yesterday, I went to the testimony. And we had him, he was dead in the water. He can't refute it. And I'm not trying to be one up on anybody. I want to just be ready to give an answer to every man, a reason for the faith and hope that's within me with meekness and fear. That's all. That's all. And we, all of us, need to be in that kind of situation. Okay. Oh, my gosh. Yeah. 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 Well, Alexander was used to destroying cities. When he came upon Jerusalem, great walled city, that was like saying sick him to a dog, except for one problem. When he came there, there was a high priest coming out of the open-walled, open-doored city with a procession of priests, and they were carrying a scroll of Daniel. Book of Daniel, because they were doing what God told him to. The high priest went before the altar of the Lord when he heard that Alexander was coming. He laid down and went almost like in a trance. He got a vision of what to do. And he saw that procession. He said, put on your white robes, your ephods, your very finest. Put on your mitre and put on your breastplate that has the 12 stones for the 12 tribes of Israel. Put it all on. In other words, go out in style. It came out, and they were singing holiness unto the Lord. They were singing that. This is Josephus. I'm quoting him, not the Bible. And Alexander fell from his horse like he was hit by a rock. The problem with Alexander was he had had a dream about that same vision the night before, that God had already told him what was coming. Like, is God present in all this? In fact, he read from that scroll that you're mentioning. He read from the, I got goosebumps thinking about it. He read from the book of Daniel 100 years before how he predicted Alexander's coming and that he would defeat Cyrus and the Persians would die under Alexander's ministry. Alexander was dumbfounded. He was the only Gentile we know in Scripture was allowed to go inside the temple and into the Holy of Holies. He was allowed to go in there. And that's the only Gentile, non-Jewish person ever allowed in Scripture. In the history, as far as we're concerned. Amazing. So Alexander then went down to Alexandria, and he brought down 70 scribes from Israel that copied the Hebrew prophecies, who Alexander was transfixed by them, copied them into the Greek language. It's called the Septuagint. That's the Greek Old Testament. And it's still around today. Alexander's work was never burned. And when the Alexandria, the library was burned, it never happened. These historical things just blessed my socks off because I say Jesus has always been there. before, during, and after. He is present. Amen. If you're not sure about the presence, you just mentioned it. All the Old Testament prophecies, not just the prophecies, the narratives. Who do you think Jacob is wrestling with in the darkness? Or who do you think Nebuchadnezzar looks into the furnace and sees these three guys and they're not crispy down there? They're not blackened. They're walking around and talking to each other in the midst of a fire. And the fourth man, he said, there's four men. We put three in as four, and the fourth looks like the Son of God. This is an unbeliever looking in and seeing that. That's amazing, the presence of the Lord. Okay, I'm going to get Pentecostal and start preaching if we keep it up. I'm just, it's good stuff. I mean, there's so much stuff in Scripture and history that the Bible is true, that Jesus is in the midst of our situations and circumstances. He was there then, He is here now. Amen. Because Jesus is, somebody who said that already this morning, He's in our hearts. So He goes where we go. Amen. So, can you give testimony of any life situations? Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it's the power of God to salvation. Everyone who believes, the Jew first, also to the Greek. But we are surrounded by skeptics and unbelievers. It's true. The question is, can you give testimony to His worth in your life? I want to take you back to another historical thing. There was no cell phones, telephones, telegraphs, no television, nothing for communication. All they had was the Roman roads. And in fact, the modern railroad is built on the Roman roads. I don't know if you're aware of that. There was so many inches between wheels on a chariot, and then those Romans went all the way across their realm on those Roman chariots driven by horses. And it was the width of two horses wide. And that's where they put the wheels. And the ruts are still there in the Appian Way, it's called, the road from Rome to the Holy Land. It's still there. Those ruts are still there. And that's the same track that we use for a railroad today. Same distance. It's amazing. But the point is they made their journey on by horseback. These messengers, like, think of the Pony Express, if you will, made their journey on horseback. They would give the town criers, who was the head spokesman in the town, the information that they needed, and they would run off to the next one, and the next one, and the next one, until they went all the way through the realm. And town crier, at the proper time of the day, would yell out, all you who are here is the word from Rome, you know, and then they would cry it out. And the particular, it was like a type of oratory. They were well thought of people in that time. In that culture. But the question is, can we do their job of declaring the good news of Jesus? You know? The same methods are still available, except that we've got all this other stuff. I heard guys, we just recently left the cable and we're using satellite. I found 15 stations this morning where we're talking about Jesus, and out of the 15, 12 of them were talking about money. It was kind of disappointing. They were supposed to be Christian stations. But people haven't heard the good news. And Jesus is present in our act of kindness. In Mark 11:41, that's the last page of my material. For whoever gives a cup of cold water to drink in my name because you belong to Christ, surely I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward. And one of the fruit of the Holy Spirit, one of the nine fruit, is kindness. You see them listed there? Would you read those with me? But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Cold water to a thirsty traveler on a hot day. I call it the basic milk of human kindness. We have people coming here for emergency food, and they'll be walking. One little lady comes over here with a stroller with a little kid, and Lois always grabs the cold water and hands them the water, you know. And we're just doing what the book says, but it's more than that. They're thirsty. They're hot. They're tired. Give them something to refresh them. Kindness is so simple. Okay, Ben-Hur, written by General Lew Wallace, pictures Judah Ben-Hur, the central character, and he offers the kindness of a cup of cold water to Jesus, as Jesus is going down the Via Dolorosa, the road that's called the Path of Tears or Path of Roses, on his way to the cross. And he is transformed just by looking at Jesus as he gives him the cup of water. So Jesus is present when we do that. So it's beautiful. Jesus said, when we are kind to the least of these, his brothers, we're offering kindness to him. Amen. Matthew 25, I was hungry and you gave me, would you read that with me? I was hungry and you gave me food, thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. The king will answer and say to them, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, you did it to me. Amen. He's present in our acts of kindness. He's present in life's storms. Psalm 34:17. The righteous cry out, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all. Underline the word all. If you didn't do it, think of it. Do it anyway. All their troubles. God will, if God will take you to it, he will take you through it. May not take you through it the way you want to. You guys were really disappointed on Friday. But can you believe that God was in charge of that? It just takes a stretch. But let's think about it. If that girl had have gone into that CAT scan, which works on magnetic resonant imaging, and the magnetism is so strong, it could have been life-threatening. So is there Romans 8:28 in that? Absolutely. Absolutely. The trouble is that when we're going through it, we are so frustrated. Because sometimes when we are the most, listen, out of control, she had some metal in there. When we're the most out of control, sometimes he is the most... Thank you. You're a preacher too. Okay. So he promised never to abandon us. And he said in the Great Commission, we kind of breezed over this. He said, Lord, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. So stay focused on Jesus. Look within. Be depressed. You'll hear me see the sermon all the time. Look at the world and be distressed. Right now it's very distressing. You know, and then look at Jesus and be at rest. God's peace will be found in the place of your focus. Be sure you look at the right things if you want peace. Keep your eyes on him. You're not defined by your circumstances. So many times we feel that way. Oh, I'm hopeless. I can't get out of this, you know. You're defined not by your circumstances, but by who you are in Jesus. You're his kid. You're his child. Do you love your children? With all my heart. With all my heart. And he defined us by his death on the cross when he called us beloved. Ephesians 1:6. To the praise and glory of his grace, wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved. We are his beloved children. He loves us. I wanted to end this message with a song. I'm going to play it on the digital projector, and then Lois is going to play the chorus, and we're going to learn it or use it together. If you look at the last page, you'll see it all listed there. Look at the last page. Guys, the song that I'm going to show you right now was probably recorded in the late 90s. Yeah, he's a tremendously gifted young man. Wrong. Let's go back out of that. Go back again. Get the right one. Here we go. And here we are.
I sense an awesome moving of the Holy Spirit, and I see his countenance resting on your face. I know that there are angels covering all around us, for the presence of the Lord is in this place. Thank you, Lord, for being